We're honored to have Colin Weatherwax, Chief Executive Officer over at America Can Cars for Kids. Colin, are you hanging?
How's it going, Frank? Thanks for having me.
Absolutely an honor, man. And I'll tell you why. I've got a lot of shop owners, and we talk about this typically at the bar, you know, at a trade event. And we're like, you know, we're kind of grouping what we do commonality-wise, you know, whether we're in Texas or Florida or Arizona, California. And I got to say, this program that you have at Cars for Kids is an incredible program. And a lot of our clients are like, oh, wow, I didn't know that exists. So kudos to you, Colin, and the team there, because it's a great program. So with that said, let's dive in. What's your role there? And what is this all about? How can folks help?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm Chief Executive Officer. I've been with the company for 12 years. So it's actually a really fun story. I came in on a Saturday. Saturdays are when we have our auctions. And I was just, you know, checking out the auction and helping out some customers. And the next week, I'm actually working there, cleaning out the cars and taking pictures of the cars. So that was about 12 years ago. And now, fast forward now, I'm running the company. So
that's crazy. I gotta stop you there because something happened. We got a lot of folks hanging with the show that that run into stuff and they don't. Well, I'll just back up and say they don't trust their journey. You had no idea that you'd eventually get to this trajectory of sort of running your team and sort of leading the way. What was that like while you started? What were you thinking in that journey in between? What kept you going? And what did you specifically do? I heard clean cars. I heard auction. For people that don't know, what auction? And is that tied into the charitable?
Yeah, absolutely. So like you mentioned, you know, whenever I came to work on a Saturday, I was actually currently working at an animal hospital. So had no intention of switching careers at the time. And, you know, was pleasantly surprised and had a blast at the auction. And so the auction is exactly what you think it is. We take these donated cars and we sell them in a public auction. So it's a live auction. So you know exactly how, you know, intense and just fun that whole experience is.
Oh, it gets your blood going.
Oh, for sure.
In fact, I'll be honest with you, Colin. Greg and I talk about this often. You know, we hit the auctions here in Scottsdale and I got to sit on my hands because I'm raising my hand. Frank shouldn't be raising his hand right now.
That's dangerous.
Hey, Colin, you get that way? I mean, you get excited.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, we get the donated cars. So most people think, you know, those are the cars that are left at the shop, like you mentioned, or, you know, cars that have been sitting in the driveway for 15 years. And, yeah, absolutely, that's the case. But, you know, every now and then, and I was listening to the beginning part of the show, I've seen some Porsches run through. I've seen those late model 90s, those early model 2000 Porsches that are in really, really good condition, you know, get donated to us, and I get to sell them.
Yeah, that's awesome.
It's a blast.
Now, listen, I got to ask you, because a lot of folks are listening. Some are a little sketchy about the whole charitable, you know, does the money go where it's going to go? Can we just, right out of the gate, before we explore the fascinating history, can you set the story straight? What's it going for? How much does it get to the kids? Like, what? How much of this is really going to the kids? Tell us about that.
No, it's a great question. And like you said, it's something that's on the front of everyone's mind whenever you're donating a vehicle. And what we like to say is 100% of the net proceeds go back to the kids that we say we support. And so what does that look like? You know, we make about, you know, $10 to $15 million annually. We're giving about 20% of that back to the neighborhoods and the communities and the cities and states that you live and work in. And so obviously there's an overhead, obviously there's a marketing team that, you know, we have to pay to have our name out there, but we're all in-house. So whenever you call us, you're going to get someone that's actually in our office. That's a really cool part of it. And so, you know, what we're doing is we're helping the kids that need it the most. These are kids that are not necessarily bad kids. These are kids that have been dealt a bad hand in life. And you know that as far as, you know, as much as anybody else, there's kids out there that have been dealt a bad hand. We all get dealt a bad hand. And we're just trying to help them out and give them the best possibility for a brighter future.
No, I think that's awesome. We have a few neighborhood groups here, Greg, that we participate in. And in fact, we get together with dentists and attorneys and, you know, we'll do the car end of it. You know, Single Moms of Arizona, Helping Hands is one group.
There's the Fountain Hills Concourse.
Oh, we have a show out here. And in fact, I just got to tell you full transparency, Colin. My house is your house. Just so you know, if you're in Scottsdale, Phoenix, we're taking...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, just stay away from this time of year because it's hotter than a mug. But
I'm actually going to be there in November.
Nice. Well, you're going to definitely look us up. But my point is, what I really enjoy, you mentioned auction. It seems like many of the auctions across the country, of course, we have some of the Big Daddy, Barrett Jackson. We have Mecum comes to town. There's always some sort of like charitable component. We have the, what you mentioned, Greg, up in Fountain Hills, the concourse in the hills.
For the Phoenix Children Hospital.
PCH, Phoenix Children Hospital. They've raised over $1 million for those kids at the hospital. So that's cool. So we all get it. Charitables are just not existing. There's overhead. You got to keep top of mind aware. Let me ask you, do you ever invite the kids over to the auction and get them a vibe and feel? And then follow to that, do they ever come work for the auction? They get that excited. Has that ever happened?
Yeah. I mean, actually right now we have a current employee that is actually still a student at one of the schools that we are a benefactor for. So, you know, they were looking for an opportunity to kind of give back to the organization that gave so much to them. And so that particular individual, his name's DK, he actually is where I was around his age. I was taking pictures, cleaning out cars, and he absolutely loved it. I mean, like I said, you get to see just about anything and everything. You know, we're a used car lot for the most part, so we have the late model 90s. We have, you know, sometimes we'll get a Bentley. Sometimes we'll get a Rolls Royce.
Uh-oh.
And it's really exciting and you know, get to be a part of the auction. And at that age, you know, there's so much adrenaline that goes with watching an auction. You know, it's really exciting. So we love to give back. We love to give these kids an opportunity that they wouldn't have had otherwise. And so if they're given an opportunity to come work for us, absolutely. Absolutely, we jump on that.
You guys get on a carsforkids.org. We'll have that in show notes. I got to ask you, what's the big misconception with folks regarding the whole tax thing, right? Because it's a tax deduction.
Yep.
What's the common misconception, Colin, if you can put it out there? Because some people may feel like, well, no, I don't want to do that.
Yeah, that's what makes people nervous. So that's a great question.
Yeah, like, you know, some people, I've heard it.
Oh, that's going to be a red flag with the IRS.
Or something to that nature. What could you tell people to give them a little peace of mind about how it really works and it's really not rocket science?
Right. Absolutely. We try and alleviate all the hassle that comes with donating a vehicle or getting rid of a vehicle. Frank, as you know, selling a car these days is a hassle. Posting it on Craigslist, posting it on Facebook, having a stranger show up and drive your vehicle just for the possibility of getting a cash buyer is a scary thing, especially nowadays. So we love to remove that hassle. We love to make it an easy process. So you just give us a call or go to our website. We take care of the rest. So we make sure the paperwork is nice and tidy. If you don't have the title, we're going to work with you to try and get that title. And then we're going to work around your schedule to get the vehicle picked up. And then as far as the tax write-off, you get a 1098C tax form. Now, you do have to submit that just like any other tax year. You have to submit it with your tax advisor, and then they'll tell you, you know, what that actually works for your income as you know, you as a person. But, you know, we give you what we sell the vehicle for. The common misconception is that they can get that Kelley Blue Book value, and the IRS actually changed their rules back in 2014 that a significant repair has to be done to that donated vehicle in order to qualify for fair market value. So you can't just go on Kelley Blue Book and say, oh, my car is worth, you know, $5,000 and it's all in pieces and expect to get $5,000. So, but we do try and get the most money that we can out of every donation. Obviously, if we sell it for more, that's more going back to the kids, and that's our main mission.
Yeah, and I'd like to add to that. I think it's important. A lot of you are on the fence about, man, do I put the money into the ride and do I not? I've said this from day one. You can get on wrenchnation.tv. We've got a ton of great shops across the country. I know them all personally. And I know that's a large claim, but the fact is, I do. And what I'm telling you is, these folks, they'll give you the straight and skinny. These are automotive professionals that will tell you, hey, you're looking at some serious issues. Your vehicle has cancer. They're not going to put a Band-Aid and take your $500. They're going to give you the long-term outlook. And so then naturally you can kind of segue, well, I don't know if I want to sell it to somebody else because it is what it is, but it goes to auction. And the original carsforkids.org, they'll take the car. They're helping kids. It's a win-win. Colin, you've been in the news, man. You recently were recognized as one of the dealers, 40 under 40. Are you under 40 as the CEO?
Yes, sir. I'm 31 years old, and that's why I'm coming to Scottsdale. That's where the conference is at.
Right on. So what? Hey, tell us the secret. What's in your cornflakes? Because you're kind of young to be a CEO. You're driven, brother.
Absolutely. And, you know, I started out taking those pictures, cleaning out the cars. And then what did I do after that? Obviously, it's been 12 years. You don't just go from cleaning out cars to CEO. So, you know, I was on the phones right after that. I was talking to donors, interacting with donors, listening to the stories. These cars, they all have stories. Everyone on this show knows that, and everyone listening knows that. So it's fascinating to hear the stories behind some of the cars that are donated. And so from there, I looked into title paperwork. I was managing the title department. I was running the consignment program that we had, eventually moved into assistant director, director, and then chief operating officer before being elevated to chief executive officer last April. So I've kind of seen the gambit over the past 12 years as far as the vehicles come, but I know my roots. And so I can look at, you know, an employee that works for me that's going through, you know, they have a phone call with a donor and the donor's, you know, really on the fence about donating that car that's been in their family for 30 years.
And oh, so yeah, the sentimental.
I tell them, yeah, look, put yourself in their shoes. This is their baby, and their baby has just got cancer, like you said, Frank. This is a very difficult time for them. Let's make it as easy as possible.
Yeah, I'm like a do not resuscitate, donate.
No, I know I like that's that. Pretty, I like that a lot.
Well, I mean, the thing I'm hearing from you, and I want to go back. I mean, America Can, the original Cars for Kids, the tagline, right off the car, not the kid. That's beautiful. It speaks, yeah, it bam, is. Bam, bam. That you're making it happen. But I got to get back to your story because we got a lot of students on campus. We got a lot of folks listening to the show. It seems when folks start their journey, entry level, we've all been there. And I still clean a toilet, Greg. We do what we got to do.
Have to.
You lead. There's a difference between management and leadership. You influence that. That's leadership. But let me ask you, you ever were at a crossroads, Colin, where you're like, oh, man, I like this, but I got this super opportunity over here? Because the question to you is, some of us think the grass is greener over the other side. And mm-hmm. I'll add to that, we may chase money. Mm-hmm. In other words, man, they want to give me another $10,000 a year. So how do you hold fort? How do you know not to give up and time messing with your head? What advice would you give to someone that's on their way and they just got to hang in there?
Yeah.
Respect.
So from an entry-level position, the main thing that I was I was curious. I always asked questions to other departments, to my supervisors, and just said, hey, is there anything else that I can learn? Is there anything else that I can help with? And by doing that, you know, it makes your resume stick out from the rest of the crowd, first and foremost. And then pursuing my education was something that I kind of put on the back burner because I love to work. I love interacting with people and working and, you know, everything that goes with having a career. But I quickly realized that this was the job that I wanted for the rest of my life. And so in order to do that, I have to have the credentials to back it. So last May, I got my master's in business.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And whenever you talk about the grass being greener on the other side, there's always going to be opportunities out there for just about anyone. I mean, Frank, you've probably seen it from day one for you. But for me, you know, now, as you said, as a 31-year-old CEO, I'm going to have people that are going to come up to me and be like, hey, we've seen what you've done. How about you come over here and show us how to do it for this company? And what I look back on is I look back on, you know, my start And where I am today, I would not be where I am today without the people that believed in me and the people that work for me now. And the team that I have around me, I wouldn't trade in for all the money in the world.
Hey, give a shout out to Colin. We got to recognize the team. Give a shout out. Drop some names.
Yeah, absolutely. So we have Amanda Hollins. She's my chief operating officer. I've known her for about 8 years. She's been my chief operating officer for 2 years. Excellent human being. Ex-Dallas police officer for 15 years. So I was able to kind of pry her away from that career and start her second career as my second in command.
She keep everybody in line.
That's for sure, right?
Big D officer. Don't mess around. Keep everybody in line, yeah.
Definitely. We also have my chief marketing officer, Raul Machuca. He's been, you know, by my side, actually holding the camera probably 8 years ago whenever I did my first Facebook Live video for the auction. I'm stiff as a nail. I'm stuttering. I have a script. He now knows that do not send me into an interview with a script.
Right.
So yeah. And then at the end of the day, the team's great. The job's the best. But what we are there to do is to help these kids. And seeing these kids every day and seeing them succeed based off of a vehicle donation, I mean, you can't put a price tag on that. It's so fulfilling, and it's what, you know, it's what we were put on this earth to do, is to help other people. And
yeah,
so
no doubt. There's some great influence fulfilling. It's a little bit of the mantra of the show. No matter how dark and dreary it may be in your life, there's always somebody else that's got a bit more difficult. In fact, you can change your tonality and your spirit by just, if you think you're on the bottom, go donate your time. Just go just do that. You know, no matter where you're at in life, you know, donating your time, no matter where you're at on the bottom, there's something about that that starts to turn it around, you know, and you don't do it for anything but the love of, you know, humanity and just helping out your fellow man or woman. I got to ask you, in terms of taking a vehicle, what won't you take? I mean, is that something like, my car is missing wheels. I got some frame damage. Do you have certain criteria? Talk about it.
We want it. Everything that you just said, we want it. So
wow.
We take vehicles in any condition, running or not. Like you mentioned, you have all your partners with the shops, and you know, you go to the shop, you get a phone call from the shop director's like, hey, you know, I need you to come up here. We got to talk about your Honda. And then they give you the news, like transmission's bad and it's going to cost X amount to get it fixed. That's the type of vehicle that we want. We want those vehicles that have seen it all, because there's a buyer out there for them. And, you know, they might not fit your life anymore as the previous owner. But what we do with that vehicle by reselling it, giving it another purpose, we're also taking the money that we take from that vehicle sale and giving it to a kid and repurposing their life to make it better. So,
all right. So, listen, I'm in New Jersey. I got a car. How does that happen? How do you make? I mean, I'm trying to put my because you're out of Texas.
Mm-hmm.
I'm calling you from Jersey. I got a car. It's an old Volkswagen. I sprechen Sie Deutsch. I want to trade it in. How do you handle that? Give folks an idea how that works.
Go to our website, carsforkids.org. Frank, you mentioned it. Give us a call anytime. Basically, what we're going to do, Frank, I'll use you as an example. I'm going to get your first and last name. I'm going to get your address, where to pick up the vehicle, where to send that tax receipt, and I'm going to ask you for the VIN number for that car. We're going to check all of our systems and make sure everything checks out. If you have any questions about the title paperwork, let's say it's in you and your wife's name, then we're going to ask, hey, you and your wife, can y'all both sign the title? Yes. Perfect. Let me submit your information into our tow service. They're going to give you a call and schedule a time that works best for you for us to show up and pick up the vehicle. We're not going to show up in, you know, the crack of dawn or in the middle of the night and just pick it and, you know, give you a call the next day and say, hey, we got your car. No, we work around you, and we're going to get that vehicle picked up. We're going to take care of the hassle and send you that tax write-off at the end of the day, probably about 4 to 6 weeks after we pick it up. And then also you could be eligible for a $50 Visa gift card. So you get a gift card and the tax write-off.
All right, let me ask you, Colin. CEO is not easy. You got your challenges. Stolen cars.
I was just going to go there. Verification, verifying.
I know
VINs.
You can verify VIN, but, you know, with washing titles and, right, Greg, there's some of that
you
going on.
You have to be
on.
Careful.
You guys are on top of it. Can I ask you how much of a challenge that is? Is it a nothing burger? Give the folks insight about how you make sure that those cars are legit. And if you have a story to share or can share some of that process, I mean, that's just more sizzle regarding, you know, we know that cars are stolen. You don't want to deal with that. How do you avoid that?
Yeah, absolutely. So whenever we get that VIN number, we're going to check all the systems we have access to just to see if there's a record on any of the DMV sites. They're really good about putting that record on there where it says stolen or gives you a notice and says, hey, this is in, you know, John Doe's name, and I'm talking to Frank. You know, there's something not adding up there. But, you know, at the end of the day, after we check those, and there's always the turnaround time in the DMV, right? So let's say, for instance, you know, a car is stolen, and then that next day we get a phone call and say, hey, I want to donate it. There might not be that record on the list that says, hey, this car has been stolen because they're still processing it. So, you know, we've had that happen a couple times. It actually doesn't happen as often as you think it would. We've been blessed that way. And, you know, with working with all 50 states and all 50 DMVs, Frank and you guys on the show, y'all know every single state and every single DMV is different. So mm-hmm. the fact that it hasn't happened that many times is a blessing, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of a silly question. Most of your thieves aren't looking to, I stole this car. Let me take it. You know, they're not.
Yeah, but I just
thought, you know, inside how you keep paperwork clean, and you guys are doing that, which is awesome. Let me ask you this. I may not have a car to donate. Is there other ways that I can donate?
Absolutely. And you asked this question earlier. I forgot to answer it. We accept cars, boats, RVs, buses, motorcycles, and also, at the end of the day, what does everyone love? Cash. So we also accept cash donations, and all of that still goes back into everything that we say it goes back into. It goes back into helping the kids.
All right, the future. We got a lot of our baby boomers that are retiring. We're probably going to see a lot of those cars transition. You know, that's a big number every year. It's increasing. What's the future for cars for kids? What are you seeing 3 to 5 years out? Maybe another auction house or expanding that house? How do we double efforts to help back?
We love the idea of expanding to another location. You know, one of the things that we're trying this year is having these type interviews with such as yourself, Frank, and, you know, getting the message out there that the original Cars for Kids is here. We're here to stay, and we're here to help out kids. And
the OGs of Cars for Kids. No fancy songs or singing or jingles.
None of those.
The real deal.
That's right.
Bam.
Right.
Simple, straightforward. They got your back. You got a car. Your hoopty needs to retire. Get it out of your hair.
Be repurposed.
You got black widows growing underneath that sucker. You don't even know it. It's time to donate. Carsforkids.org. Got a question. You're out of Texas. Has Richard Rawlings made his presence over at your place yet?
He has.
Absolutely. Yeah, baby, because if not, we were going to get you in touch.
No, we had a vehicle donated to us that he repurposed.
Nice.
For the one and only Mark Cuban that we then raffled off probably about 8-10 years ago. It was a great experience. Love Richard.
Yeah, no, he's a spirit. And I'll be honest with you, we had him in, we waited to be quite frank with you. We wanted, he had a little clearance after he got off the Discovery because we wanted this straight and skinny. He's a lot more relaxed.
Oh, yeah.
You know, TV can be pressure. So that's good to hear. You know, just Texas in general, it's huge. But it's not that huge. It seems like, you know, we're all connecting the dots. I've got a good friend out of Midlothian. I'll just throw out his name, Jeff Buckley, my father's shop. He does a lot of community work out there. And so now that I know where you're at, I'm going to try to get you in touch with the associations out there in the automotive industry. Speaking of which, how are we doing as an industry aftermarket? Of course, we can speak for. How's the aftermarket? Are we supportive? Is the average garage owner thinking top of mind Cars for Kids for donation? Do you have to pull teeth? What's going on? We behaving?
We are working with some partnerships actually with you know the shop owners, and so we've had an agreement with one city garage here that's more local in the DFW area. And they had an issue. They came to me and they said, hey, we have people that we give them the bad news. We give them the diagnosis on their cars and they stop returning our calls and just leave the cars. And I was like, okay, well, what can I do to help? And he said, well, can you just come get him? And I was like, okay, are you going to give me their information? And he said, yeah, we'll give you their information. You can work with them, get the titles, and, you know, a clear space on my lot. And so I think to date, this was probably back in, I would say, January of this year, we've probably gotten about 50 vehicles donated from those shops that would have otherwise just been collecting dust. And what does that do? 50 vehicles that we were able to repurpose, resell, and, you know, go back to our mission of helping kids. So
no, that's awesome.
Garages is a big thing, thing down here.
So if you're a garage owner, body shop, collision, we all know the method. There's paperwork and this stuff, and we got to DMV it, and it becomes a headache. And if you got 20 of these on your lot, you need to pursue carsforkids.org because they'll get in and
help.
And I'm into that. Like, it's a loss. I want it out of my hair, out of sight, out of mind. So right now, there's some fall cleaning. Forget spring cleaning. Clean up your lots, people.
Yeah, clean those cars out.
Yeah, get those cars out. Greg, any last questions? This is kind of fascinating that we got the OGs of Cars for Kids on and I think it's because what I like is it goes right like it does. It's not some chintzy, we send a party hat to a kid. No, right? This is substance.
Yeah, no, Colin, I actually have one question for you regarding the auctioneer school. Was that test hard to do?
It was. It was definitely hard to do.
Wow.
I've heard some stories on that test.
Yeah. It took me a couple tries, but licensed and as an auctioneer. Love subbing in on the auction block every now and then on a Saturday.
Hey, let's hear that auction voice.
Yeah, give us a little bit of it.
Go ahead. Floor is yours, Colin. Cars coming up the block. Go.
500. How about 6? Lever 600. I got 5 now. 6. Lever 600. 5 now. 6. How about 600? And sold.
Oh, I like it.
Wow, that was a little peppy, like cheery.
That was impressive.
Yeah, that was good. Aiden, give us your auction voice. We'll put you on the spot. Go.
Oh. You know, I actually never tried to do an auction voice before.
Hey, improvisation is everything. Give it to us now.
Hey, Aiden, we got a car going for 500, 500, 500, and we got a 450 over here, which is weird, but hey, whatever. 450, 450, 450. Hey, and 500 sold. 500.
All right, you said weird. You probably made everybody walk out.
Yeah, I was sitting here. I was like, oh, interesting.
Elvis, do you want to try your
voice? Oh, yeah. You know my voice?
Go ahead.
My voice is sold, sold, sold.
Yes.
My voice? Oh, snap. I didn't buy it. It's not me.
Not me.
You know, that's the thing with auctions. They're a lot of fun. Whether you're going to sort of this mass volume, you know, we have some big retail, well, I should say wholesale auctions with a lot of dealers and buying program cars and stuff. But Greg, man, so they call me because they,
hey, Frank, we want you to check out the cars.
Yep.
Like I'm some sort of mechanical whisperer. And I'm like, you can't even drive the car. This is the mileage, so good luck.
Right.
But, yeah, I find it all fascinating. And we so appreciate, Colin, you stopping by. We know you're busy. You're out of Texas. But this is a nationwide thing for you listening. Carsforkids.org. A great way, a great cause. And Colin, people can get a hold of you. And it sounds like you're in the trenches. If folks aren't sure, you got a great team, but you're approachable.
Absolutely. And I know my roots, like I mentioned before. I'm not above talking to a donor and giving them a peace of mind. You know, one of the things that I love to touch on are the kids that the money that we raise, the kids that it's going to support. So here in Dallas, and in Texas thereafter, we go to support kids that are looking for a second chance at their high school diploma. They're looking for that high school diploma and potentially certification so that once they graduate, they can have an industry-based certification and they can walk into a potential job and a potential career, and a vehicle donation goes to support that here in Texas. And we have other partnerships outside of Texas. We support the YMCA. Which I don't have to, you know, do a spiel on the YMCA. Everyone knows they go to help kids. We also have another partner in San Diego called the San Diego Center for Children, who's been around for over 125 years, focusing on mental health services for kids and their families. So it's a lot of fun, and giving back, you know, at the end of the day makes everyone feel good.
No, it's a good cause, and I'll just add to the list, man. Ranch Nation, we are in your pocket. Anything that you need from the show, our network, we've got a ton of shop owners and industry folks. We'd love to help. Count on us, and we'll have you back. I'd like to follow up. And congratulations, Colin, again. the recognition that you're receiving. Your grind, hard work, influence, and team leadership is what it's about. So November, maybe we can all hook up. If we don't, man, good luck with that. That's a great ceremony.
Thank you so much. Thanks for the opportunity. Appreciate y'all's time. And Wrench Nation.
There you go. Thanks for being on the show.
Yeah, right on. CarsForKids.org, the original gangsters of Cars for Kids.
Gangsters.
I'm going to say it. Real deal. Money going right to the kids. No fluff, no puff, none of that kind of stuff. A lot of you have a vehicle, whether it's in your house or your commercial property. These folks will get it done. So CarsForKids.org. Last parting words, Greg, anything happening with you? You going to be anywhere where folks can see you?
Not anything exciting right now, but I do have the newest edition of Drive Magazine that I want to give you.
Oh, nice. I'll take it.
I know they took a little hiatus, but now they're back. If you look at the cover, it's a Mustang, but it's an EV.
Whoa, so that's sick.
I had to give it to you.
I'm going to take a picture of this. Get onto Wrench Nation Twitter, Facebook, all the socials. This is an EV500.
Mustang.
Yeah. What am I looking at, 65?
65 or 6, I think it is.
Yeah.
Look at the logo on the quarter panel or the rocker panel, EV500.
That's crazy. That's a trend now. In fact, Shelby, I was approached, hey, Frank, why don't you do conversion EV? I said, well, I'm still learning. I'm kind of scared. I'd be Frankenstein blowing stuff up. But you can catch the Drive Magazine all over online. We'll put it in show notes. This particular issue, October 2023, Remembering Ken Block. Ken Block, there's a whole tribute to that. Grand National Roadster Show, Cruising for a Cure. It's a great magazine. It's well put together. That's Drive Magazine. So always an honor to spend it with you. Thank you, Mr. Greg Overston, Studio. Aiden, you rock, brother. Thank you so much. And remember to visit carsforkids.org. As I tell you every week, be safe, hug each other, and never forget to hug a mechanic.